Today I will talk about, as a first part, on the, what is the production of level 2 data, for which you are all here eventually. And we'll just talk about some, how we generate a few basic observables without doing actual spectral polarimetric inversions. We'll talk about a little bit about that tomorrow with Ivan Milic. We are planning on organizing at least a follow-up workshop more dedicated to spectral polarimetric inversions. So, as you all know, physical quantities are not directly observable. We cannot just stick a thermometer in the sun or measure its magnetic field or velocities directly. We'll have to derive these quantities from the spectrum and its polarization state. And this derivation of physical parameters from level 1 calibrated spectra is called level 2 data production. That's just to define that process. The major points that I would like you to take away is that Phil probably talked about this as well on the first day. Opacity varies strongly with height. And this gives us an opportunity, of course, because at wavelength with higher opacity, the intensity forms in a higher layer of the atmosphere. And by varying the wavelength at which we look, we can probe different layers of the atmosphere. You can think of it this way. The atmosphere is at one wavelength is divided in three parts. The deep part, from which the light will never go through the surface because there's so much material that it's always absorbed. Then there's the top part, which is so thin that it actually does very little, contribute very little to the observable signal. And then there's the middle part. That's right at the right optical depth. That is the layer from which you see the intensity coming at a certain wavelength. And that layer obviously varies a lot with wavelength. And one of the most efficient ways to appreciate or use this effect is by looking at a spectral line, because the opacity strongly varies across a spectral line. And this is ideal that over a short range of wavelength, you can actually probe different heights in the atmosphere. So those are the main things that I would like you to take away from this presentation. So overview what I will talk about. I'll talk a little bit at length about understanding spectral line formation, because I think it's essential that you understand what a spectral line actually is and how we can use it. Some of you, of course, this may be very familiar and it may be boring, but I will go through it anyway. Phil did some of it as well, but I think repetition in this case is not so bad. Then I'll talk a little bit about how to determine temperatures with a very easy and simple radiation temperature estimate, see how that comes about. Then I'll talk about a few methods for deriving line of sight velocity, just as an example of how, without an actual inversion, you can still derive some of these quantities. And then Ivan Milic has prepared some exercises about line formation after this. And he will talk about how to measure the magnetic field in a simple ways after this presentation. So, spectral lines. We will talk about mostly lines in thermodynamic equilibrium. Did you talk about this, Phil? I wasn't here. But you talked a little bit. So, essentially, the atmosphere of the sun in the lower layers has enough mass and enough thermal mass that the flow of radiation is small compared to the amount of radiation or energy that is contained in it. And so, just like an oven with a little pinhole, the material and the radiation field are in equilibrium with each other and are described by a single parameter, namely the kinetic temperature. And that means that the radiation field is given by the Planck function, the velocities are given by the Maxwellian distribution, and the ionization excitation are given by the Sahar-Boltzmann rules. So let me just put down the basic equations of relative transfer so that it's easy to see what we're talking about. If you have absorption in an infinitesimally thin slab, then the intensity coming out in a given direction and per time and etc. Is the intensity that goes in plus the delta I, and in this case is absorption, is a negative number, minus the absorption coefficient alpha times the intensity times the path length to this element. Same with emission. Emission is a positive term because it adds photons to the process. And there's the emission coefficient eta, and there's no dependence of the intensity here. Then we define the source function as the ratio of the emissivity over the absorption coefficient. And sometimes we have, at one wavelength, we have different processes that take place at the same time. We cannot just add the source function because we just have to add first all the emissivities and add all the absorptions, and then the total source function can be written as a sum, as the ratio of the sum of the emissivities divided by the absorption coefficients. Sometimes when you have a continuum process plus a line, you can simply split it out where this ratio, the relative weight for these two source functions, is given by the ratio of the absorption coefficient for the line and the continuum. Now we can combine both absorption and emission and write the equation of relative transfer like this. Di, ds, the change of intensity along the path length, is what is emitted minus what is absorbed. We can bring alpha to the other side and just write and define optical depth or optical path length tau as d tau is alpha times ds, and the optical path length of a slab of finite width is the integral of this quantity over s. This is very informal, so interrupt me in any you want. Typically, in relative transfer, because the atmosphere is considered to be semi-infinite with depth, we define optical depth rather than optical path length, and that gives us a minus because dz, the height in the atmosphere, goes opposite to the direction of the radiation field that we look at, and that means that you get a change of sign in your equation of relative transfer. This is sometimes confusing, but the only reason that that sign changes is because of this convention, that optical depth runs opposite to height. There's nothing complicated about that. Now, if we looking not vertical into the atmosphere, but would look at an angle, then the path length gets divided by the cosine of theta, which is the angle with the normal, which usually is written as mu, in this way. Again, the simple equation of relative transfer. Now, this is a deceptively simple equation. It looks like the simplest differential equation that you can basically imagine, right? But all the trickiness of this equation is hidden in two ways. A, the absorption and emission coefficient depend on the microphysics of the atmosphere, which is sometimes you need very fancy quantum mechanics to understand that. And B, the source function S, in general, depends on the intensity itself. So this is not a closed equation. And that is mainly the case when you have non-LTE lines, and we won't talk about that today. Maybe we'll talk about that a little bit tomorrow. And otherwise, certainly in the next meeting, we'll address it more. So with a simple integration trick, you can rewrite this differential equation into an integral equation. This equation is now called the formal solution. Of course, if you have an infinite atmosphere, this term tau goes to infinity, so this term disappears, and you just have the integral from 0 to infinity over this source function times e to the minus tau. If you have a homogeneous medium, and the test or the exercise that Ivan will show will use this equation, then you can just analytically integrate this, and then you have that the intensity is the that you get from a slab is the intensity falling on one side of the slab plus or diluted by optical depth minus tau, and the source function that is with a term that is contributing from the material, and the self-absorption of this contribution in the slab. When you have an optically thick medium, so tau of over d is very large, of course this term disappears, this term disappears. The intensity that emerges on the other side of the slab is just the source function. If you have an optically thin slab, then you can make the approximation of e to the minus tau is 1 minus tau, and you get this expression. And if you look carefully, you can see that this term can be positive or negative, depending on whether the intensity falling on your slab is higher or lower than the source function. You can actually have an emission or an absorption profile. So let's make a very simple approximation. So I write down the formal solution for an infinite atmosphere, and this is the expression for the intensity at the surface coming out of the material. And let's make the simple approximation that we approximate the source function as a polynomial in tau. Then, using a simple algebraic equality, we write down this. We can integrate this in parts. Analytically, and we find that the emergent intensity at an angle mu, at a cosine theta equal mu, is A0, the first coefficient, plus A1 times mu, plus higher order terms. So if we throw away all the terms in gray here, we find that the emergent intensity at an angle mu at the surface is basically the source function at tau equal mu. And so in the vertical direction, this means that the emergent intensity is approximately the source function at tau equal 1. What I mentioned, this is the optimal layer of where you see most of the radiation coming from, because the deeper layer is all obscured by absorption, and the top layer is too optically thin to contribute much to the signal. Now, if you have a temperature gradient that decreases with height, as it does in the solar photosphere, as we know, and you compare the intensity that you see in the vertical direction at tau equal 1 or at tau equal mu, where mu is smaller than 1, you can see that because of this, the shell or the ray being at an angle, that the optical path, for the same optical path length, you actually see lower temperatures at the angle. So you can see directly from this that the intensity at point in direction A will be larger than the intensity in direction B. And this very simply explains the limb darkening that we see. When you look at the sun in the continuum, you see that the intensity at the limb is less than intensity at this center. And the way this comes, and what this means, of course, is that the temperature in the solar photosphere decreases with height. So if you have a source function and you look straight into the atmosphere, you look deeper into the atmosphere. You see higher temperature, and then the closer you go to the limb, you sample a lower and lower, lower source function, and the intensity goes down. And so you get, depending on where you look, you see less and less intensity. Yes? No?
Can you explain why whenever you move towards the rim, the line is going higher in the atmosphere?
Okay, so let's go. So when you move to the limb, when you look at an angle, why the intensity comes from a higher layer? So remember that optical depth is opacity times path length, right? And so for the same opacity, we have a longer path length because of this shallow angle. So for the same optical path length, we reach higher or we sample higher layers. Right? It's just a geometrical effect of a lengthening of the path length that makes you sample higher layers for the same optical path length. So here's a part of the spectrum shown in two different ways, one as an intensity plot and one as a basically line, spectral line plot. Why are spectral lines dark? Why are they dark? Or why are these spectral lines dark? No one? Piyush? Yes, and? Absorbing more is a dangerous term. I will show you. That actually, it's good that you say that, because I wanted to make that point. We'll see. So Phil showed the same plot, and I'll go through it again, because it's a bit of a complicated plot.
I got it completely wrong.
You got it completely wrong. OK, I'll give it a go. And I practiced hard this morning, so I'll try. This is, for those of us who know, this is a Rob Rutten plot. So it would be quite a different show if he were talking about this than me. I'm his first PhD student, by the way, so I can say that. So say we have an absorption profile as a function of, we use frequency and wavelength interchangeably. Of course, they are one-to-one related, right? So as a function of frequency, but I'll just say wavelength because it's easy to relate to. The opacity, the absorption coefficient alpha, changes strongly, right? In the core of the line, the opacity is much larger than in the wings of the line or in the continuum. Now, remember that integrating from the top of the atmosphere inwards, the optical depth is a product of the path length times the absorption coefficient, right? So when the absorption coefficient larger, this optical depth grows much faster than in the core of the line than it does in the wing of the line, right? So ignore these two points because they are just confusing. Now look at where optical depth unity is in the atmosphere. Optical depth unity in the line core is high up in the atmosphere, right? Because the opacity is so large. Optical depth unity in the continuum or in the line wing is much deeper in the atmosphere. Now, we know the run of the source function as a function of height, and we sample in the line core, we sample the source function at this place, at this height, but the optical depth is unity in the line core. Then we sample optical depth unity higher, deeper in the atmosphere at a higher source function value. And since we're talking LTE, basically you can replace S with the Planck function or temperature. And therefore, in the core of the line, we sample a lower temperature and therefore get a lower intensity than we get in the continuum or in the wing of the line. Right? So a line is an absorption in the photosphere because the temperature decreases with height. Right? Now, be careful if you say there's more absorption in the line core than in the line wing, because there's also more emission. Because for Kirchhoff's law, so I remember the Planck function is just the source function, it's the emissivity over the absorption coefficient. To get the emissivity, I have to multiply by the absorption coefficient, right? So at this height, the absorption, the emission is also larger than the absorption, right? Because they both go with alpha. Yes?
Yeah, but I think you said that
no,
the ratio between absorption and emission is different.
I know. I just wanted to make a point. Sorry, Piyush. but this is a kind of a misconception about spectral lines, right? Because spectral lines are not there because there's more absorption. Spectral lines are there, they are dark in the line core, because you sample a lower temperature. And that's quite an essential point. Correct. Yes. So there are ways to get a source function that decreases with height in a constant temperature. And that could be a non-LTE effect, but we're talking about LTE lines in this case. Now, this just to give you an example, this formation height optical depth unity is not well known and is not constant for a given line. This is, for instance, for the sodium, one of the sodium D lines. This is optical depth in the in the line core where this arrow points. And you see as a function of, so this is a vertical slice through the solar atmosphere. These yellow things here are the granules. They are hot, and it's cooler up here and even cooler up here. And so if you were to apply Eddington-Barbier, right, you would say that the intensity at this wavelength in the line is about approximately the source function at this height. And this is actually a plot of the source function, not temperature, but they are very closely related. And this is the continuum optical depth unity at the same, or right next to the line. You see that the height from which you receive information in the core of this line wildly varies through the atmosphere by hundreds of kilometers. So you cannot say, well, this line just forms at what is the average is 500 or 600 kilometers. Because it doesn't. It forms all over the line, all over the atmosphere at this wavelength. And part of that is because there are variations in density, and so you look through two variations in density when you look down. There's also velocities which shift the line and change the opacity that way. It's just something to be aware of. Then, hey, we have emission lines. How do they come about? Lily, you can tell me. Yeah. So when you look in the solar spectrum, all the lines short of 160 nanometers are in emission, or most of them, and all of them above are in absorption. How does this come about?
In various ways, I would say.
That's a safe answer. Yes.
I would say from higher
layers. Yes. And what happens at higher layers?
Is
increasing. That's correct. We have, so in the solar chromosphere, or what defines the chromosphere, is that we have a temperature, we have a source function that goes up with height, because temperature goes up in the chromosphere at height. So now we play the same game. We have a spectral line with an absorption profile. We have the optical depth as a function of height for the different wavelengths, much steeper for the line core than for the line width. And now if we sample at different heights,
Let's
funny, like I said, and I've found Robin Hood the Papa left that. But if you didn't drop that for almost nothing, you can still see it. But now you've got that little bit of emission.
Yeah.
Now in the ultraviolet, instead of being an infrared, it's a really bright swapping light. It's got nothing to do with the source function. It's just integrated optical thin emission on the line of sight. That's all it is. Very, very simple. And one of the things that Rob has always told me is that, you know, there's very few people that couple the thin and the thick parts of the atmosphere together in one job. And so you tend to have solar physicists that deal with non-LP and LP, and you tend to have coronal physicists. I think that's really silly, because it all comes from the same physics, which is this stuff, but it's different regimes in that physics. It's the minority thing, how bright it is. That really is that physics. Yeah. And that chapter I wrote, it's provided with this stuff, is supposed to help explain that. So I'm just taking some of your time, because I think it's so valuable on my mind.
Just to show you that the Edison Barbier, although it's a very simple relation, you should not take it for granted, or you should take it with a grain of salt, a complicated salt. This is a bit of a complicated graph, but this is the source function of the temperature line here, the white is also that unity for one of the C-band, one of the lines of the C-band. C-band is a band of molecular lines of the C-H molecule. These yellow rays here show the relative contribution of the intensity at this location in the atmosphere. So if you look at this, so this is horizontal, they get a horizontal cut through the atmosphere, x along the slit if you want. This is height in the atmosphere. And now if you look at what the intensity at this point in the atmosphere is, and you look down at where this intensity comes from, then the width of this yellow curve describes the relative contribution of that height to the intensity. So you see that in general this contribution actually comes from a layer that is slightly deeper than optical depth unity. And it actually extends over quite a range of a few hundred kilometers. It's not just one point in the atmosphere. So keep that in mind. Now, secondly, if you say, well, so let's look at, again, I'll explain it back. So this is, again, a vertical cross-section to the atmosphere. Temperature shown here, these are the granules, the top of the granules. There is optical depth unity and optical depth 0.3 and 3, these two layers. And this is where typically most of the intensity comes from between these two lines. So Edison Barbier, as I said, in the vertical direction should give you the emergent intensity at these x locations should be the source function. So temperature compared to the source function that we've got the wavelength. Of all the points under this line, under the solid line, right? And so that is shown here in purple here. Right? Now, what I've done is I've taken the calculated intensity and here a Planck function converted to a radiation temperature. And that is what is occurred in black. And so you see that Edison Barbier is proper or close at these peaks of these values, when the gradient is steep, but it's certainly not a good approximation, differing by a few hundred Kelvin in those places. So yes, that is about the age, a very useful approximation that we have to take into account.
If Edison Barbier is mostly a good approximation at the top of the granule, why is it not a good approximation at the top of that line about 3.9 millimeters?
You mean here?
Yeah.
I have no idea. No, I mean, the radiation is not an easy, and it's a very homogeneous amount. So what exactly causes that? I don't know. It might be how quickly the opacity changes compared to the temperature, whatever, how that works out, but it's So it's not, it's a very non-linear process on how we work. Well, so as I said, the dash and the dotted line are optical dash 0.3 and 3. So that gives you the sense of how much that changes around the time. Yeah, I'm sure. Around optical dash 3, the equation of optical dash is basically supposed to be driven by the scale hypothetical. So there I'm saying. So let's move on then. Now we all understand how spectral lines work. To how we can determine them. As I've said, when LTE holds, the radiation field is given, the local radiation field is given by the quantum. So here I mean, sort of very diagonal quantum for the temperatures and the functional wavelength. At a given wavelength, the quantum function is really monotonic and a very non-linear function of temperature, right? For the load, this change here, especially in the blue, is very exponential and it's all over the world. And this is also something to be very aware of. If you average spatial elements in similar area, but at short wavelength, then those areas that are hot contribute a much larger part to the total intensity, right? Because of this whole area with a bunch of them. This is the formula for the quantum function. Now, let's play a simple game. This is the spectrum of the large range of wavelength of the solar photosphere. Does that look like a plant function to you? Yes? So one simple way to estimate the temperature of the solar photosphere would be, well, what is the plant function that they... Okay. Oh, I don't know. So one simple way of estimating the temperature of the solar photosphere, what that actually means, right? Would be to see which is the
temperature of a Planck function that gives the closest match to this curve. So let's try. The nominal effective temperature of the sun is 5770 Kelvin. That doesn't seem to work very well. In part, that is because the effective temperature is calculated from the integrated disk light, so it has the limb darkening in. So it makes sense that we underestimate it, right? But in this part of the spectrum, it seems to do a reasonable match. So let's go to 6,000. It seems to be a little bit better. It's like Kevin said, meh, right? Let's do it even better, or worse in some places, right? Because now here, it really doesn't matter. We overshoot. Well, here we are still not estimating it right. Here the temperature is still higher, right? So we cannot characterize the solar spectrum as a simple Planck function. How so? Anyone any idea? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So basically, at looking at different wavelengths, we see different layers of the atmosphere. And especially here at 1.5 microns, we look deep into the atmosphere and see a higher temperature than at all the other wavelengths. So this is not the the spectrum of one layer. This is a spectrum that is composite at different wavelengths from different layers and therefore at different temperatures. And the reason for that is this. The bulk of the opacity in the photosphere in visible wavelengths and infrared wavelengths comes from a process that is called H-. Hydrogen can actually capture another electron and form a negative ion that has one spectral line, this one, and also has what is called free-free opacity. So the free-free, the bound-free opacity is ionization of H minus. Right? And it has a wavelength dependence that is shown here in red. The free-free process is a hydrogen atom with an electron flying by, and that's a free-free process. And that is that increases steeply with wavelength. Now, the sum of the two has a maximum at about 860 nanometers, but it has a minimum at 1600 nanometers. And this is exactly at 1.6 micron, where we look at the deepest layers in the atmosphere. Here, we can't actually see the continuum, because there are so many spectral lines in the blue and the ultraviolet that you never see continuum anymore. So that's why the deepest layers that you can see are actually only visible in the infrared there. But it is why this curve in the previous slide has this big bump here. Yes?
I'm under the impression that I heard or read somewhere that the solar spectrum is not a perfect black body because
yes.
The light that should be there, it's taken out processes.
Well, to a degree is true, but what the absorption lines do is they also change the height at which you get
light.
Your light, yes, yes. So now I cheated a little bit because this is a calculated spectrum that has very few lines. So this is mostly continuum, just to make the point, because otherwise it becomes very confusing. So this is just a theoretical spectrum without most of the spectral lines, but just to make the point. So now imagine that you have Dekist and that you can take pictures like this, which, apart from seeing effects, is not unreasonable, because we have instruments that are capable of sampling an area like this at this kind of resolution, which means that we will have of each pixel here, of the 4 million pixels in this picture, we will have a spectrum.
And we
Can you you can't tell?
No.
Ah, that's disappointing. That's disappointing that you can't tell. Well, but you asked the question.
No, it was just because I couldn't read the.
I see. Well, look, that's better. Yeah.
This is a simulation.
Of course, we don't have Dekist, so that's what I'm saying. Imagine that you have an instrument that can.
It is obvious that it is a simulation, even without Dekist.
There's a whole story behind this, but we won't get into this. So now this would give us, with the proper tools and analysis tools, right, gives us the opportunity to determine the physical state at each pixel. But that's a lot of work. Let's take a simpler approach. So what we can do is we can calculate for each pixel, of course, Dekist will give you is just counts. At each location, you have a certain number of counts, right? It won't give you an actual physical intensity. You have to somehow calculate that. And one of the simplest way to calculate is that I'd say, well, normalize your counts with the average quiet sun intensity that you can get from an atlas. Those are all available online, right? And you normalize that with the average quiet sun count number, and then you have an actual physical variation of intensity over your whole pixel. And then you can just, the Planck function is a simple function of temperature, so you can just invert it and you say, well, now I have a radiation temperature as a function of the intensity at each pixel. Right? So this is more or less applying Eddington-Barbier at that wavelength and saying, well, the intensity is about the source function at that wavelength at optical depth unity. And so the radiation temperature is more or less a measure of the temperature at optical depth unity. Remembering, of course, that this is not a constant height in the atmosphere, that it varies with per height. And so this looks exactly like the same picture, except it is, of course, now scaled a little bit with the nonlinearity of the Planck function. And so these are the radiation temperatures varying from slightly below 4,000 to slightly above 7,000. So this would be a very simple thing that you can do to see, well, what kind of temperatures, how dark is, how cold is an umbra compared to the solar photosphere, etc. These are things that you can easily play. By the way, this was an image that was calculated from a simulation at in the red continuum, which is one of the VBI wavelengths. Yes?
And that is, you might think, oh, Bill doesn't know what he's talking about, which is fine. I often don't. Because what I said then was, we don't know why the sun is obliged to form a sunspot. Yet here is a simulation. Can anybody answer why my claim is true, and yet they're still able to make this?
What was your claim?
My claim is that the sun, we don't know why the sun should make a structure that looks like a spot. Yeah, there's a simulation that looks just like a spot. So what do we do? What could be the resolution of those two things? The answer is, that's determined by the boundary conditions and by nothing else. If you allow, and the boundary conditions, as we know in physics, is what we don't know. So the sun is providing a boundary condition underneath, and that's the part we don't know. And also on the top, it's providing a boundary condition in which sunspots will not form with a penumbra unless you put some force on the top of it. So it's on that basis that I say the sun, we still don't know what causes those boundary conditions.
But you can turn it around in a way and saying, well, the sun must be doing something that this boundary condition is like it is. If that's the only way.
That's a unique answer.
No,
I agree with you.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to make that clear, because one of the things I'd love to come out of the VKIS project is some of you guys to look into the in such detail into spots that you can tell us what the hell caused that to happen. That would be a fantastic.
I'm pretty sure perfectly right. Here is formed, the upper and the lower boundary.
Yes.
That are totally formed to look like a sunspot.
Yes.
But that's because we saw the sunspot.
Exactly. Yeah. We're used to sunspots. People think, oh, that can't be very complicated. But you still don't have an explanation as to why they should exist.
And it's good that we have this situation. It's excellent. Now we need to understand what are these boundary conditions that we're not expecting.
So that's a challenge for you guys. Figure out what the hell causes a sunspot with VKIS.
And by the way, the upper boundary is in the chromosphere. I think the lower boundary is not accessible to the VKIS, so it's
going
to be
really No, I mean, Helios as well, you would be the only thing that gives you some.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I understand. I know.
Yeah, good luck with Helios as well, telling you something about the upper boundary.
Yeah.
But the upper boundary is in the chromosphere.
Yeah.
So that's accessible to the I'm just trying to understand what's going on there.
Okay, so last topic, and I promise it's just a few slides. How do we determine line of sight velocities? Of course, you all know the Doppler effect. Maybe it's offensive that I even show this, but parcels moving towards or away from you, of course, change the wavelength, and we can use this effect to measure actually velocities, where the wavelength and the velocity are related via the speed of light. And the rest wavelength of the line. So if we now have a small section of the granulation, we put our spectrograph slit and we take spectra, we see that where the slit crosses the granules, we have a shift of the line towards the blue, and where we have a downflow, like here, the continuum is dark, obviously, and then the line is shifted towards the red. And we can easily measure this. There are several ways. One way would be to measure the position of the minimum of the line That gives you usually a fairly good measurement. But you can see if you have a line that is magnetic and it splits, like here, it splits into two components. Now the minimum of your line is either one of these lobes and has nothing to do anymore with the velocity. So this is kind of a dicey method when you have a line that is magnetically sensitive and forms in a region where there are strong magnetic fields around. So you can do slightly better. And so this is similar what is here. You can define the center of gravity of a spectral line, which is you just integrate the wavelength times the difference between the continuum and the line, basically the line depth over wavelength. And so you can look at this at the center of gravity as basically the wavelength weighted with the depth of the line, right? And so that takes into account the whole line, and that gives you, even when the line is split, gives you a very decent position from which to derive the line of sight velocity. Now you can actually do, and in the same way, and I don't know, Ivan, will you mention this or not?
A little bit more complicated.
Yeah, okay. So I won't talk about the magnetic field because Ivan, so in the same way you can actually do the center of gravity of the left and right hand circular polarized lights, which are typically are not split. They are shifted with respect to each other, but these components are not shifted. So it's easier to determine their centroid, and then you can derive the line of sight velocity more accurately even this way. So these are very simple tricks that you can use to measure velocity is fairly accurate, and you can actually show with simulations to a degree that you believe the simulations to be like the real sun, that this center of gravity estimate for the line velocity is a very good estimate of the velocity at the actual optical depth unity. And then finally, there is the line bisector method, which works in the following way. You define a number of intensity levels indicated by the blue lines here. You measure the intersection points, the wavelength of the intersection of these intensity levels with the line profile, and then you take the midpoint of these intersections. And now you have a way of measuring the line shift at each of these intensity levels, and therefore in different layers of the atmosphere. Of course, these are the higher layers of the atmosphere, these are the deeper layers of the atmosphere, right? And if you plot this midpoint and you convert it to wavelength, then you see that there is a clear change in the velocity, there's a clear gradient in the velocity over height in the atmosphere. And that is something that you can derive using this bisector method. And I think that is, the next steps, Ivan will talk about magnetic field determinations. And tomorrow we'll talk more about more formal ways of using the whole spectral lines to derive physical properties of the atmosphere in terms of spectral or spectropolarimetric inversions, which is where we eventually want to go to get more accurate information as a function of height in the atmosphere. So, thank you.